We have a granddaughter.
Do you know what's wrong with my granddaughter?
The baby's blood is different from the mother's. The baby requires a two-volume exchange transfusion.
Then give her one.
No one here has ever done that procedure.
Then get someone who has.
We spend much money for doctors.
I would have spent every penny I have.
You'd like to hold her? Nono means grandpa.
Try and break that match. All right. Now you take five of them. You take 10 of them. You tie them together. You can't break them. That's a union.
Your union is going to get us all into trouble.
It's not my union.
You were fired before. Hasn't that taught you anything?
Maybe it taught me we need a union because I was fired for the wrong reasons.
What'd you hear about the union?
They don't want us there.
I'm there.
I hear they fire anybody signs a union card.
They can't fire you for voting to join a union.
Time to wake up. I made breakfast.
You?
After 25 years of marriage, it's time I cooked something for my bride.
25 years. I look every year of it.
You look the same as you did the day I met you. Only more beautiful. I'll get your room.
What exactly did you cook?
Toast.
Toast?
The toast was the one item that survived. Here, slip this on.
Oh, my.
Ruth Sloan is wearing chinchilla while your kids need shoes. I bet that fur coat set old man Sloan back a few bucks, huh?
About five and a half G's is all.
That's more than I make in two years.
2 years. You got it. Ruth Sloan's coat costs more than you earn in 2 years. People can't keep their eyes off this coat.
Got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between. You gotta spread joy up to the maximum, bring gloom down to the minimum. Have faith or pandemonium, liable to walk upon the scene. To illustrate my last remark,
Jonah in the whale, Noah in the ark.
What do they do just when everything looks so dark? Man, they said you got to accentuate
the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative.
Don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between.
Diaper ointment.
Two containers each.
And the baby soap and fingernail clippers and the diapers.
Three dozen.
Is that enough?
More than enough. And we have extra for burping cloths.
And the receiving blankets.
Six, four cotton, two wool.
Petroleum jelly for cradle care.
And a small baby brush to work it in with.
And if we forgot anything, Abe could get it.
Did you put fresh towels in Gina's bathroom?
Yes, I did.
Well, I hope it's Gina. I can't wait to see the baby again.
That baby is the spitting image of our son.
I couldn't agree more. She's as ugly as he was.
Mike was a beautiful baby.
Certainly he was after 2 months. When his hormone rash disappeared, his hair started to grow in and the swelling on his nose subsided.
I did not delude myself about the appearance of my newborn. Mike was one of the homeliest infants I had ever seen.
He was not.
And I am pleased no end that this new infant is as hideous as he.
Ruth, I'm glad you're making peace with Gina. She's a lovely young woman.
If being civil to my daughter-in-law is the price of seeing my grandchild, so be it.
Which reminds me, don't mention the Jewish business.
What?
It's going to be awkward enough without anyone mentioning her religion.
I thought she was Catholic.
One does assume that about Italians, and Catholic would have been bad enough. But this, well, who knew? Our son was one for surprises.
Here they are.
Well, hello. How lovely you look.
Thank you.
Abe, take your suitcase up to Mike Jr.'s room.
Yes, sir.
I'm so pleased you're allowing us to help you, Gina. These first weeks are so crucial for the baby and so difficult for the mother.
Can I hold my granddaughter?
Are there any special needs we should know about?
Needs?
Any special foods you people eat?
Thank you, Ruth Sloan. We needed a fur coat, we got a fur coat. It's time to petition the National Labor Relations Board and call a vote.
By my count, it's still close.
It won't be.
There are a lot of people still on the fence.
We'll push them off.
Eddie, you were just telling me how much your kid loves playing at Elwood Park. Does anyone need reminding how that park got built?
With profits that grew 113% during the war.
With money out of their own pockets.
With money out of your pockets, because that's what a tax deduction is. Tax dollars paying for what rich people like the Sloans take credit for. I say, if the Sloans want to donate to charity, why don't they share some of their surplus wartime profits with their workers?
Because we earned them.
Because they took advantage of the war efforts to line their own pockets.
Because we took the risks. Because we made the capital outlays. And you think...
Am I bothering the baby?
She is fine.
You think from the way they talk that reconverting to peacetime production happens with the wave of a magic wand? They want wages based on a level of profit no one can guarantee anymore.
What we want are wages that make up for what you've already lost. Otherwise, you will always be one contract behind.
Reconversion cost us one hell of a lot.
Oh, I've got to watch my language around the baby.
And it's still costing us money.
Have you ever noticed that management always claims to be broke, but they'll never show you the books? The sky is falling whenever you ask for a raise. But there's always plenty in the bank for their salaries. The question is, who is looking out for you? Your union or your boss?
Let me ask it another way. Who's providing your job, your union, or your boss?
Who's protecting me or my job, my union or my boss?
You wouldn't have a job without the Sloans.
The Sloans wouldn't have any profits without us. They're not making anything but money, Hank, and we do the work.
Oh, now you're talking like a communist.
You're talking like an owner.
Does anybody want my opinion?
Hell no.
Just get us a beer, Mutt.
I want to bring Emma's bed into this room.
It's not healthy for mother and child to share a room.
Why not?
Doctors have shown it causes an excessive dependency. You mustn't run to Emma. She's only testing you. She's fed and diapered and perfectly comfortable.
She needs something.
She needs to develop her lungs. My dear, how can we teach our children to be strong and independent if we pamper and coddle them? If we run to our children every time they cry, they come to expect it. And then it's mommy, 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 morning, noon, and night. See, there. She fell asleep. If you must, you can go and check on her now. She won't know you looked, and therefore you're in control of the situation and not your infant. Shh, shh, shh. Gloria.
will not have my grandchild spoiled.
Yes, ma'am.
What are their chances of winning? 2 months ago, not good. But today, pretty darn good. A union in my plant. I don't understand the disloyalty. How's the baby?
She'll be fine if people in this household can keep from spoiling her. Why not lay off a good percentage of the workforce to shorten the work week and watch their loyalty return?
Because we have the biggest backlog of orders since we reconverted, and we don't
want to slow down delivery.
You can put this at the feet of a handful of malcontents. The real loudmouths are the 6 or 7 at the top.
Linda Metcalf is the first one. Is that intentional?
The biggest mouth of all.
Well, she may require special treatment.
You've got potential, Linda. Lots of potential. You've got a good head on your shoulders. Got a pretty darn good sense on how this factory operates. And most of all, you've got your feet on the ground.
I do.
You're pragmatic. That's a real asset.
Those are a lot of compliments, Sam. I'm getting nervous.
Oh, there you go. Well, you're feisty, too. Not afraid to speak up. Though some people would call that disrespectful.
Sam, I was kidding.
Please, I know you were. I know you were, and I admire that sort of thing, because it's a sign you're willing to speak your mind. And not everyone's willing to do that.
When did you start admiring that? Why didn't you tell me before?
Oh, we've always had our eye on you, Linda. Because we're always on the lookout for management material.
Management? I'm not management material.
Oh, don't be modest.
I wasn't.
There's no need to hide your light under a bushel, Linda. I've been authorized to offer you a position on our staff.
Sam, how can I...
Don't say yes or no right this minute. You can always say no after you give it 24 hours. Take a couple of days if you need to. Here are the details, salary and all. Let me know.
It is not time for that child to be up.
Come in.
Gloria, would you make us some coffee? Have you lost your senses? Didn't those nurses teach you anything at that hospital? Cannot feed that child from your bosom and expect her to thrive.
I've seen many healthy babies eat from mother.
Not in this country. Doctors have discovered more advanced ways of feeding them. Surely you want the best for Emma. We all do.
She was hungry.
Well, I don't know why you assume that. It's not time for her to be fed, and I didn't hear a peep out of her.
She did not cry. When I wake, she's making movement with her mouth to nurse.
You brought her into your bed?
That is why she did not cry.
When did you bring her in?
Last night.
Last night? Well, no matter how comforting Emma's presence may be to you, you must put her safety first. You could have smothered the child.
I'm sorry.
We almost lost her once. We wouldn't want it to happen again. That woman will kill the baby before she's 6 months old. Gloria, can you believe breastfeeding in this day and age?
I can't. And to take that child into her bed.
The National Safety Council puts out brochures to inform the public of these very dangers. What happens? I get a peasant Jewess for a daughter-in-law.
It's just ignorance. Gina has good intentions.
Gloria. You must watch that baby like a hawk, do you understand?
like a hawk.
I come because I think that maybe Emma gets sick again. And maybe Emma die. And Mr. Sloane tell me that he take care of her the best possible, but this is not the best.
Don't you realize the Sloanes can afford the best medical care available? Now, it is because of them that your baby is alive and kicking today. You must follow the doctor's advice. For Emma's sake. I am going to post this schedule for all of us. Now, Emma gets her formula every 4 hours and not a drop in between. She has 2 naps a day and has to be in bed for good at 8 o'clock. And Gina, that child must sleep in her own bed.
Do you believe this, Gloria?
I wish I had known all this when Robert was born. Mrs. Sloane was right. If we pick up Emma every time she cries, we're going to have one spoiled child on our hands.
Jeff? Hi.
Why didn't you tell me you were coming home?
I wanted to surprise you.
Some surprise. I found out from your landlady after I spent every dime I had on bus fare to Los Angeles. I also spent 4 days in a seat with no legroom. I got sick to my stomach from cigarette smoke, gagged on bus stops.
If I had telephoned, it wouldn't have been a surprise. Besides, how on earth could I know you were coming to see me?
You tell me someone wants you to pose naked for pinups and don't expect me to get on a bus?
I don't remember asking you to ride to my rescue.
At least you finally wised up and came home.
I came home because I realized that I have to build my career from the ground up, and my cousin has a job at the radio station. He got me a part-time job so I can work my way up to national radio.
You're going to start this all over again?
Oh, quit being grumpy. You're just tired and hungry.
No, I'm tired and fed up. I was a fool to go back to Hollywood. The very same place where you left me at the drop of a hat without a by your leave. Now you want to chase after some radio career? Well, you can do it without me, sister.
Jeff! I know I can make it this time.
This is WREQ Radio, voice of Greater River Run.
One moment, I'll connect you.
This is WREQ Radio, voice of Greater River Run.
This is the most ingenious playpen. It has a top so the toddler can't get out.
That is a cage like the Germans used.
Heavens no, it's for safety. To prevent the child from hurting herself.
We did not pick up that child unless it was for a feeding, a bath, or a diaper.
And her lungs are already the stronger for it.
She's hungry between her 4-hour feedings.
There. Crisis over. You may all rest easier now.
She was hungry.
How is that poor child supposed to learn her schedule if none of the adults learn it?
Robert never ate on a schedule. He was hungry all the time.
It's our fault. We didn't train him properly.
Thank you, Gloria. Now, I'm going out, and while I'm gone, I don't want any of you disturbing this poor child's rest by continuing to pick her up and coddle her. Linda, lovely coat you're wearing.
Thank you.
I understand how you feel about my fur. I no longer wear it out of respect for your convictions.
Mrs. Sloane, it's not the coat.
No.
It's what it stands for.
Goodness. You oppose sentimentality and devotion, which is what it stands for. was my husband's anniversary present to you.
I didn't know that.
Of course not. How could you? Knowing that fact wouldn't have prevented you from attacking me, would it?
I didn't intend to attack you personally. I was trying to make a point about wages.
Linda, my husband and I worked very hard for many years to make our business a success.
So have your employees.
And you are a very ambitious and outspoken young woman. You'll be quite successful, I imagine, at whatever endeavor you choose. If your success brings you financial reward, as my husband's and mine brought us, will you refuse it?
I would hope I would share it with those who helped me.
As my husband and I have. Not just by providing jobs, but through charitable contributions at the Davis's Bethany Baptist Church, for one.
And paying Gina's medical bills, for another.
Thank goodness we had the money when we needed it. As one gets older, one's responsibilities multiply. One day you'll have children and grandchildren of your own, which is why I, frankly, am baffled by your lack of response to our job offer.
Mrs. Sloan, isn't this offer meant to prevent me from working with the union?
That would be very short-sighted on our part. What possible benefit could accrue to us by having a discontented person on our management team? The labor movement is very strong in this country. Do you feel your contribution to it is somehow unique?
You seriously want me to be a part of your company's management?
Absolutely. As office manager, you'll be in on all staff meetings. We'd be looking to you for suggestions for how to streamline operations as much as possible.
And you don't mean just firing people?
You tell me.
Well, I've always thought that when an employee's job has been eliminated, that it should be company policy to retrain that employee whenever possible and find him a new position within the firm. That would be good for morale.
I knew Sam recommended the right person for the job. That's exactly the kind of thinking we need to hear. Please give us your decision soon. We do need to fill the vacancy.
I'm very proud of you. Not many people get an opportunity like this.
So you think I should take the job?
I also know how much work you've put into the union.
So?
A parent can't make a decision for a grown child.
It's the first time in my life I want her to tell me what to do, and it's the only time she doesn't. Hank, I need your advice.
Oops, sorry. Mike Sloan pulled himself up by his bootstraps. He worked harder than you and I ever dreamt of, and he built a factory that provides work for this city. You almost married his son. You could have been a Sloan yourself. If Mike had bought you a nice coat, like I planned to buy Sarah someday, would you have turned down his gift?
I can't imagine I would have.
Which I guess means rich people aren't necessarily evil because they have money. And poor people aren't inherently good or noble just because they're poor.
Am I going to hear some advice?
There's no choice as far as I'm concerned. You bellyached about losing your job as a welder, and now you get an even better job offer and you can't decide whether to take it? Tell me where the logic is in that. You want to stay poor to prove a point?
I think it's a good job offer. I think you'd make a very good office manager.
But?
No but.
You're not going to try and talk me out of taking the job?
No.
You're not going to try and talk me out of it?
No. Look, we both know they offered you the job to shut you up. But there's no reason you can't take the job and still keep your standards. Hold on to your ideals. It's been done. There are a lot of progressive people in management. And my guess is you could very well be one yourself.
Would you like a cup of coffee?
No, thanks.
Tea?
No, thank you. I'm fine.
Well, I can't tell you how delighted I am you're considering the job.
Because they have money doesn't make them any better than us.
I didn't say anything, did I?
Money can't buy everything. And I'm telling you right now, if they're not treating Gina right, I'm taking her and Emma home with me tonight. I'd like to see somebody try and stop me.
Good evening.
Hi, Miss Sloan. Is Gina in?
Yes. Come in.
Hey, Gina. I bet you thought you'd gotten rid of us by moving in here.
Charlie.
Hey, how's the little mother?
Okay, fine.
Okay, fine. It's good with me.
You look wonderful, love. I'm so Mrs. glad Sloan? You came.
How are you, Charlie? Good to see you. And you, Mrs. Haley.
Oh, Caroline.
Caroline. Let me take your coats.
Oh, thanks.
Would you like to see Emma?
Where is the little squirt?
She's not allowed to have visitors. We don't want to expose her to any germs.
I'm as healthy as a horse.
She's upstairs. She has her own room.
Putting on the Ritz, huh? Let me at her.
May I use your lavatory?
It's down the hall and to the right.
Thank you.
It is not proper to visit a newborn during the first 30 days. Doesn't anyone in this city have any breeding or intelligence? They could expose that child to God knows what, maybe even polio.
I swear, she's the spitting image of Mike.
Would you like to hold her?
Do you mind?
She's not a plaything.
Oh, hold her head.
I know, I know. Hi.
Hi, you remember me? Charlie Haley, the human taxi. She's so tiny. Can you believe how tiny she is? I can't get over it. Look at these little fingers. Wow, look at this. What a grip.
She's hungry. It's time for her bottle.
You stay here with Charlie. I'll go downstairs and get her bottle. Someone is hungry and wants her bottle.
I can't wait to see her.
Mrs. Haley, Caroline, I am so indebted to you for calling me when Emma was born. If you hadn't... Well, I want you to know that if there's ever anything I can do for you, anything, don't hesitate to ask. The bottle.
Well, it's the squeaky wheel that gets the grease, isn't it?
Excuse me?
I alphabetize and re-alphabetize the orders. I update my employer's schedules, make coffee for them when I arrive, and lock up after them when I leave, and I've been doing it for almost as long as you've been alive. My work is exemplary. And you're the one offered a promotion.
I didn't ask for it.
But you believe that you merit it, and I don't.
If you want the job, why don't you apply for it?
Because I am not prepared to bat my eyes and flaunt my legs the way you young girls are.
Do you mind if I sit here?
It's a free country.
You're more stubborn than I thought.
Only when I'm right.
Well, that's true.
What's true, that I'm stubborn or that I'm right?
Both. You have a right to be pig-headed. I realize I hurt your feelings by staying in Hollywood. And if I gave you the impression that my career is more important to me than you are, then I'm sorry.
You're sorry? Well, in that case, I want to make up, too. As a matter of fact, I think we should kiss and make up.
I'm not here.
I get off work in half an hour.
I have to work the switchboard at the station tonight.
I thought you just said I was more important than your career.
Well, you are, but I can't tell my new boss that. I mean, he's very happy with my performance.
Performance? Ginger, you answer a telephone.
But I do it with
feeling. I mean, you should call and hear me.
Well, I guess I'll have to if I ever want to talk to you again, because we sure won't have any more dates. What with you working every morning, noon, and night to become the next Harriet Nelson.
Has the laundry been putting starch in your shorts or something?
You know, I can't believe I fell for your apology.
I said, oh, sorry, I touched a soft spot. But I can't help it if you take everything the wrong way.
Oh, so it's all my fault?
So I'm the only one who has to say I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry, all right, good and sorry.
Don't forget to vote today.
Vote for yourself. Vote union.
Vote for fairness. Vote union.
Vote for a raise. Vote union.
I hear the dame chickened out.
Got my vote counted.
You hear wrong.
Vote union.
Back to Russia.
Have you heard from Linda?
The union doesn't rise or fall with one person.
Come on, Linda was the first one signed. What do these guys think if she doesn't stick with us? Vote union.
I think she'll hang in there.
Then why ain't she here?
Today's your chance. Vote union. Keep your trap shut, will you?
Hey, she's faked out. We're going down.
What if we lose?
If we lose, we call another vote in a year, but we're not going to lose.
A year?
A year, 2 years, it doesn't matter. We get left out of the factory if we lose.
Look, let's remember this is a democracy, gentlemen. Victories aren't guaranteed. And all of these Joes have a right to vote against us. Vote union.
Thanks a lot. Union.
And if we haven't made our case well enough, then these wage slaves shouldn't vote for a union.
Whose side are you on?
And if we get beat, you better be big enough to admit that it was our fault. That we weren't eloquent enough, because it's our job to sell the idea and the ideals and the benefits of having a union. And if we lose again and again and again and again, you damn well better remember that all workers, even scabs, are better off because of unions, voted in or voted out. Because every time a worker whispers the word union, or talks about it, or wonders about it, or tries to organize or call a vote, management goes running with its tail between its legs looking for ways to improve wages and working conditions, if for no other reason than to beat that union. And that's why we are here, to improve wages and working conditions. And that does not change whether Linda Metcalf is with us or against us.
Good morning, Linda.
Mr. Sloan?
Good morning, Linda. We're expecting your answer today.
Do you have any news for us?
Not yet.
He means, are you taking the job?
Of course she's taking the job. Morning, Linda.
Good morning, Sam. In case there's anyone here who doesn't know me, my name is Linda Metcalf. I've been asked to speak on behalf of the union. Some of you, maybe a lot of you, haven't made up your minds yet whether or not to vote for the union. You can only make that decision for yourself.
But you're going to give us some advice anyway.
Shut up, Ed.
Shut up yourself, Haley.
You heard him?
I don't have advice. But before you vote, I'd like to introduce you to some people who will not vote for the union.
Traitor! Speak!
Shut up.
Let it fall!
One of those people is Sam. Because Sam forgot where he came from. Sam forgot what it's like to be treated the way he treats workers. And Jack and Ed.
You don't know how we're gonna vote, Linda.
Won't vote for the union because Jack just got a raise.
What?
Liar. Liar.
And Ed was promised a promotion.
Liar.
Hey, I was in line before Ed.
There are others I would like you to meet. This is Mary Sims. Mary? 18 months ago, Mary worked here on the line and got a call that her son had been sent home from school because he was sick. She went home to take care of him.
She should have stayed home to begin with.
Mary won't vote for the union because Mary doesn't work here anymore. She was fired for taking care of her son. And this is Paul Wysocki. Paul is an experienced press operator here at Sloan Industries. Paul won't vote for the union because Paul doesn't work here anymore. 3 years ago in an accident, he lost his arm. The company paid for his hospital bills and then let him go. Another worker who won't vote for the union is Gary Linton, whose job was phased out with the reconversion. And instead of retraining him on the new equipment, they fired him. None of these people is going to vote for the union because they can't. All of you can.
Yeah, that's
right. And that's a privilege that you have. That's a privilege that you have that they don't. A privilege that you can protect, that they will have to do without. It's too late for them, but it's not for you. I'm not saying that our employers are evil people. But I know the only way to guarantee ourselves a fair shake is to stick together. I'm voting for the union.
EQ, voice of Greater River Run.
Station manager, please.
I'll connect you. This is WREQ, voice of Greater River Run. I'll connect you. This is WREQ, voice of Greater River Run.
It's me.
Do you have a musical request?
I hate fighting.
Who is the recording artist?
It's not a song and you know it.
Well, thank you for your comment regarding pacifism. I will pass it on to management.
Ginger, I don't want to fight anymore. Look, did it ever occur to you that...
One moment, please. This is WREQ.
Sales, please.
I'll connect you. Go ahead.
Did it ever occur to you that maybe, just maybe, we've been fighting a lot because...
One moment, please. This is WREQ. One moment. Go ahead.
Did it ever occur to you that maybe we've been fighting a lot because of all the tension?
One moment, please. Because of what?
Because of all the tension between us.
Well, of course there's been tension between us. We're always fighting. One moment, please.
No, I'm tired of being interrupted. That's not the kind of tension I mean.
Well, what kind of tension were you referring to?
I'm talking about physical tension.
What?
Don't you say what to me. I'm talking about just what you think I'm talking about.
This is WREQ, voice of Greater River Run.
Did you or did you not hang up on me?
We had a deal, Buster, and you are trying to renege.
Trouble with you is you misunderstand everything I say.
No, that is the trouble with you.
Oh, so now we're both saying the same thing. Maybe we ought to quit while we agree on something.
I don't think agreeing that we don't get along is a good place to quit.
We'd get along a lot better if we spent more time together. And as far as I can tell, the only time when I'm not working and you're not working is late at night when we're both sleeping. So the only way to make this thing work is to sleep together. Ow! You know, I planned this speech all day.
Nothing you say is going to convince me to have sex with you.
I say we ought to get married.
That's it? That's the big speech you planned all day?
Well, now you know. I can't dance, I can't act, and I can't write speeches. Do you want to get engaged?
The final vote is as follows. In favor of union representation, 296. Against, 252. Yeah! The petition carries.
Support the union. But you don't need me now.
What are you doing?
So I guess I can take that job offer.
What?
What? No.
Hey, better me working for management than someone else.
Mr. Sloan, Sam?
I suppose congratulations are in order. Congratulations.
Thank you. It may not seem like it to you now, but I'm convinced the union will benefit this company in the long run.
At least in the short run, my wife has no reason not to wear her new coat.
No, sir. Mr. Sloan, you said you wanted my answer today.
Answer to what?
About the office manager position. I would like to take it.
You would what?
I have resigned from the union, so there won't be a conflict.
The job is no longer available. Will you excuse us, please, Linda?
Is it because of my union work? Because you did say that my involvement with the union had nothing to do with your offer.
Of course it didn't.
Because I know that I can work within management to contribute to this company's growth. Working on the floor and in the offices...
He said the job was no longer available. Was there anything else?
No.
How can anyone be that naive?
Before I make my last speech...
His last speech? I can't believe it.
On behalf of Local 311 of the National Labor Alliance... Yeah. I would just like to thank all of you for working so hard to achieve this victory. That's right. Now, it is with great pleasure that I turn the floor over to the new president of Local 311, Mr. Charles Haley.
Yeah. No one's ever called me Mr. President before.
But I guess it's worth it if I have the authority to finally shut Al up. Yeah. All right, our first order of business is... I bet you guys didn't know I knew that lingo, did you? Is I promised that I will keep my speeches shorter than Al's. Linda, hey, you can't listen in. You're management.
Yeah. It didn't work out. I'm back to being a file clerk.
I'm president of the local. Can you believe it? Okay, before we get to whatever we have to get to, do we have any coffee?
I'll check.
Great. Okay.
Thank you.
hate hospitals.
We can't very well operate on you at home.
I will not have her in my room. Get her out of here!
I'm headed for Cincinnati.
For how long? Oh, you're leaving for good?
The responsibilities of married life are not to be taken lightly. The engaged couple should not be swayed by concupiscence, nor think of marriage as merely license to partake of carnal pleasure at will. For the primary purpose of the sex act is procreation.
I know you, Linda. Mike never stopped talking about you morning, noon, and night. You are the swellest dame on earth. Will you marry me, Linda?
I'm Ted Koppel. Later on Nightline, former President Richard Nixon talks about politics, the Middle East, and the breakup of the Soviet Union. Richard Nixon on Nightline tonight.
Friday at 10, 9 Central, she knows he's out there, obsessed with her every move. Victims of stalkers, living in fear of when they'll strike next. Watch 2020.